Savior has come, and he's coming again to save the world. Amen. Amen. I love the words of the hymns we've sung today. For lo, the days are hastening on, by prophets seen of old, when with the ever-circling years shall come the time foretold, when peace shall cover all the earth, its ancient splendors flame, and the whole world give back the song which now the angels sing. Amen. Father, we pray today that you would bless our time together around your word, as we rejoice, Lord, over you, you coming and your coming again. Bless us today, Lord. Open our hearts to receive what you have to say to us. Anoint me to preach it, and bless our hearts to receive it. We'll give you thanks in the strong name of Jesus, and God's people said, amen and amen. Amen. Great to have you in the Lord's house, and welcome those that are watching by Facebook Live or watching on our live stream here at the Hill. Glad you're watching us that way. Thank you for being in the house with us today at the Hill. Wonderful day in the Lord's presence. It's the second Sunday of Advent, amen, when we are celebrating carols reimagined. I'm loving what the choir is doing this season, aren't you? Just a great blessing. Old and new lyrics put together, old and new tunes put together. What a great joy and a great time, amen. Last Sunday we lit the candle of the patriarchs representing the hope. We learn how to wait in hope as the people of God. This Sunday we light the second candle. The second candle represents the prophets, and the prophets remind us how to be at peace. Amen. And so we light today's theme is all about the peace of God. And I want to talk to you today about the gift of peace. Say that with me. The gift of peace. Amen. What does the story of John the Baptist have to do with anything related to the Christmas story? And yet, it is the reading appointed for today, if you follow the calendar in the church here. Today's reading is Matthew, the third chapter. Turn there with me, if you will. Matthew chapter 3, we're going to read verses 1 to 12 together today. Verses 1 to 12 of Matthew chapter 3. We're going to find out that the Word of God has a lot to say to us about peace from the story of this guy named John the Baptist. My great exercise this week has been pulling these two things together. What does John the Baptist teach us about peace? Because if you remember anything about John the Baptist, he doesn't seem to be a very peaceful character at all, does he? We've sung about little Jesus, meek and mild, and now we talk about John the Baptist. This interesting guy who has a garment of camel's hair and has locust legs stuck between his front two teeth. Right? Do you remember that? His diet is locust and wild honey. I've heard people try to say, well, that was a fruit. No, it wasn't a fruit. It was a bug, just like it is today. People in some parts of the world still use insects as a source of protein. Anybody ever seen those chocolate-covered ants at the specialty stores? Yeah. Well, here John the Baptist is, this guy who's very unconventional and unorthodox, and he bursts on the scene of Israel preaching, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. It's at the door. The Messiah is on his way. And we pick up the message in John, in Matthew, the third chapter, about John the Baptist. Have you found it? Let's read it. Hear the word of the Lord today. In those days, the Bible says, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he who was spoken of by the prophet, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Now John himself was clothed in camel's hair. He had a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locust and wild honey. Then Jerusalem, all Judea and the region around the Jordan went out to him and were baptized by him in the Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, that was the church people, coming to be baptized, he said to them, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Therefore bear fruits worthy of repentance. And do not think to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. For I say to you that God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones. And even now the axe is laid to the root of the trees. Therefore every tree which does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I indeed baptize you with water under repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clean out his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. May God add a blessing to the reading of His Word, and His people said,
Amen.
Today, when we light the second candle for the prophets and talk about the peace of God, our lesson is the life of a guy named John the Baptist. What does this guy have to teach us about the peace of God? Well, three things. Are you ready? Number one, John teaches us that if we're going to experience the peace of God, then peace comes by placing Christ first. Say that with me. By placing Christ first. If we want the peace of God, Jesus has to have first place in our life. Now, when I talk about peace, I'm not talking about the peaceful, easy feeling that the Eagles used to sing about. Amen? I'm not talking about a warm, fuzzy feeling in the pit of your stomach. No, that can be cured with some Prilosec. Amen? Go see your doctor. I'm talking about the calm assurance, even in the middle of difficult times, that says God is still on the throne and I'm going to be all right. Do you hear me? It's that calm assurance, even in the middle of my trouble, that says I know that God is still on the throne in heaven, and I'm going to be okay no matter which way this thing turns. Whether it turns for my favor, or whether it turns the way I hope it doesn't go, I'm still going to be okay, because ultimately, God's causing all things to work together for my good and His glory, and I am in His hands, and anything that comes into my life was filtered through loving fingers before it got to me. And so I can live in the peace of God because I know that He is in control and He's going to take care of me. How do we get to that place where we're confident like that? Well, we have to be putting Christ first. And John the Baptist is the great example of that. John's entire life had been about Jesus. His entire reason for existing was the fact that Jesus was coming on the scene. The Bible tells us that before Mary conceived and was going to give birth to Jesus, another couple in Israel were about to have a baby, Zechariah and Elizabeth. They're the only couple other than Abraham and Sarah in the Bible who have a child when they're too old to have a child. There were other barren families that had children in the Bible. In fact, all three of the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, all three of them had wives that were barren, and God had to open their womb for them to have children. Remember that? But there are only two that had kids when they were too old to have kids. Abraham and Sarah at the beginning of the covenant. And here we have Zechariah and Elizabeth at the end of that covenant. And one gets the promise, and the other one is announcing the arrival. God told that first couple, I'm going to give you a baby, and through your seed, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. Fast forward to the other old couple, Zechariah and Elizabeth, and their son steps on the scene and says, you know that baby we've been waiting on since Abraham and Sarah? Well, that baby is here. Behold, he stands on the bank with me of the Jordan River. John comes to announce him. The Bible says John even recognized him before he was born. Remember that scene where Mary comes and visits Elizabeth and John leaps inside of Elizabeth's womb for joy, recognizing the Messiah. As soon as he recognizes Jesus is in the room with him, he goes, there he is. That's my whole reason for living and being and existing. His whole life was about Jesus. And I want to tell you, the first key to peace is when our life becomes about Jesus. When Jesus gets first place in our heart, we'll begin to know the peace of God. In John 3, the Bible tells us that John the Baptist had these disciples. And after he announced and pointed to Jesus on the banks of the Jordan at his baptism and said, this is the one I've been telling you about, many of John's disciples left John and began to go follow Jesus. Well, the ones that stayed there and stayed loyal to John, they heard that Jesus was drawing a crowd and that he too, his disciples, were baptizing people, and they got jealous. John chapter 3 verse 26 says, and they came to John and said, Rabbi, the one who was with you beyond the Jordan, to whom you testified, behold, he is baptizing and all are coming to him. What's happening here? They're jealous. They're jealous for John's sake. Their master has been upstaged by this young upstart preacher who just burst onto the scene. John answered and said, "A man can receive nothing unless it's given to him from heaven. You yourselves bear witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but I've been sent before him. He who has the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. This joy of mine is fulfilled. He must increase, but I must decrease." Say must. In the book of John, whenever you see the word must, underline it. It has to do with something about the salvation plan of God. John must decrease. Jesus must increase. Jesus said the Son of Man must be crucified and then rise. Must. It has to happen. In order for God's plan to be fulfilled, John's stock has to go down and Jesus' stock has to go up. That's the way it works. And John understands it. And John explains it to his disciples by giving the analogy of a wedding. He tells them, "Guys, you don't understand. You've missed it altogether. You have misunderstood what my place in the wedding party is." He says, "I'm not the bride. God's people, Israel, they're the bride." He says, "And I'm not the groom. The Messiah, Jesus, the one I pointed you to, he is the bridegroom." He said, "I'm just the best man at the wedding. And the job of the best man is to make sure the bride and groom have everything they need, that the bride is prepared, that the place is ready, that the stage is set, and that everything is ready to happen. And at the moment when the bridegroom and the bride meet at the center aisle, then the best man steps back up on the steps with everyone else, and he fades into the background, and everyone focuses on the bride and the groom, and the best man is forgotten," right? And John says, "That's who I am. I'm the best man at the wedding. And the bridegroom has shown up. And the wedding is about to happen." And John says, "I couldn't be more excited. This joy of mine is fulfilled. Here he is. And I'm rejoicing because my best friend's wedding day has finally come." And so John is not upset about being upstaged. He understands his whole purpose in life was to be upstaged by Jesus. He's just the warm-up act. The headliner has stepped up to the microphone. Jesus is here, and John is happy about that. You see, that's the way all of us have to learn to live if we're going to live at peace. The key to peace is understanding what John understood. Too many people today falsely believe that they are the center of the universe, that the whole world revolves around them, that life is all about them, right? I mean, we have a group of people that have been raised, and every one of them have been told, "You are special." Can I tell you that if everyone is special, no one is special, right? You are not special, but Jesus is special, and he loves you, and maybe that makes you special. I don't know. He loves the whole world. That kind of takes some of the luster off of it, doesn't it? Sorry to burst your bubble. What we need to be reminded of today is this: we are not the center of the story. We're not the hub around which everything gravitates. We're not the center of the universe. We're not the hub that all the spokes come out from. It isn't true. We falsely believe that we are the hero of the story. No, we're not. We are the ones who need rescuing in the story. Jesus is the hero in the story. He comes to rescue us. You see, whenever we begin to believe that it's all about us, we fall into a great trap. First of all, it's just not true. So we begin to live life out of this false narrative. We live out of a story that isn't real. And sooner or later, someone has to bust our bubble and pop our big head and remind us that we aren't the center, right? And it may be your professor when they hand back that paper and they aren't impressed with your cuteness, right? Or it may be your first employer who hands you the pink slip and says, "Take your special self and go work for somebody else. Because we don't have room for special here. We just have room for our own time and hard working here." Wow. Yeah. And so life has a way of reminding us we're not the center. We're not the center of anything. Really, we're not. And so we have to be able to grapple with that and be okay with that. It isn't true. Secondly, it's too much pressure for any human to live under. I don't want to be the center of everything. There's too much weight on you when you are the one at the center. You and I weren't cut out for that. We aren't made to bear the weight of the world on our shoulders. Our shoulders aren't broad enough. We studied a few weeks ago, he remembers our frame, that we are what? Dust. That's who we are. Remember that. And finally, thirdly, listen, you're wearing everybody that lives around you out when you live like you're the center of the universe. Can you imagine how difficult it is for everyone else who has to live in your orbit and gravitate around you? Right? Your mom, the dad, the wife, the kids, everybody. It's exhausting living with someone who thinks that they are the center of the universe. Amen? I mean, you go to Lids and there's not a hat big enough to fit you, right? Amen? We have to come down from our high horse. We have to step down from our throne. Amen? We are not the center. John had a very important job. He was the herald who ran before the king's chariot and blew the trumpet and announced, presenting his royal majesty, Jesus Christ. That was John's job. But John was not the king. He never let his job go to his head. He was the king's herald. He was not the king. He was not a big deal. He simply worked for someone who was a great big deal. Amen? Christ was the Word. John was just the voice of that Word. Jesus was the light of the world. John was just the one giving witness to the light. He was just the candlestick holder. Jesus was the candle burning brightly for everyone to see. John rejoiced before his birth when Jesus approached. And now John rejoiced again at the close of his ministry whenever he realized that the bridegroom had come for the bride that John had helped to get ready for her wedding day. Years ago, there was a story told of a famous missionary, Hudson Taylor. He's one of my heroes. He's a favorite of mine. He started the China Inland Mission. He was the first missionary to not stay on the coastline of China, but to actually penetrate the heart of the inland part of China and to take the gospel into the heart of the country and plant churches and send missionaries there. And he became very well known around the world for his success in planting churches and leading people in China to Jesus. While he was speaking at a church here in the United States, the pastor was inviting him to the pulpit, and his introduction was full of grand words, and he really built him up to be a mighty man of God, God's man of faith and power, and he talked about how great this man was. And then Hudson Taylor quietly took the pulpit, stood silent for a couple moments, dropped his head, looked up and said, "Dear friends, I am the little servant of an illustrious master." Hudson Taylor got it. John the Baptist got it. We are the little servants of an illustrious master. We're not the big deal, but we serve one who is the biggest deal in all the universe. And the first key to being at peace is being okay with that. It is being able to lay hold of the grace of humility. It's being able to be content with my small station in life and not get all frustrated by that. There's nothing wrong with that. Don't despise the day of small beginnings, the Bible says. Say it with me. Say it with me. I'm not a big deal. Say that with me. I'm not a big deal. Now say this, and that's okay. That's the first key to peace. I'm not the big deal. Jesus is the big deal. And when our lives become about Him, a lot of peace begins to enter our lives. Because we tap into the one who is the Prince of Peace, the peace of God. Jesus taught us that the greatest one in the kingdom of heaven is the servant, not the master. So if we want to strive to go up, the way is down. The way is by serving. We don't take up a title, we pick up a towel and we serve. As pastors, there's a great temptation for me to promote the church. There's great pressure in the world, and we're often tempted to cave into that pressure, to treat the church like a business enterprise, to view other churches like competing companies rather than brothers and sisters in Jesus, to engage in worldly marketing strategies with slick advertising to attract customers that we hope will become committed members. I humbly refuse to be part of such. We're not here to promote the church. We're here to promote Jesus. And if we'll promote Jesus, Jesus will build His church. We're not about the church. We're about the Lord. We're about Christ. We're about His kingdom. And when the Jesus name is exalted, and when the kingdom of God goes forward, I promise you the church will not lag very far behind when that happens. Amen. But our message is about Jesus. Hear me today. Christianity without Christ will make you worse, not better. If you just get the church, but you don't get Jesus when you come to church, you'll be worse than you were out there in the world. Why? Because it'll make you a hypocritical, judgmental, small-minded little person who thinks you're better than everybody else because you cleaned up the outside of the cup. And on the inside, you're still what you always were. You just dressed better than you used to. And you're still lost, and you still don't know the love of God. And you still haven't encountered the grace of God because it's obvious in the way you treat the little server girl at lunch. Amen. Quiet in the Holiness Church. Lord, help us. We have to encounter Jesus. He has to be the center of our lives. He has to be the one that everything revolves around for us. Every preacher should be like John the Baptist. Take the pulpit, point to Jesus as quickly as you can, and when His Spirit begins to move, quietly get out of the way and let the groom and the bride be able to be united together in worship. Every Christian ought to be like John the Baptist, not just talking about their church, but talking about their Jesus. Not just inviting people to the service, but inviting people to salvation. Telling people about Christ and what a difference He has made in their lives. And we only invite them to church so that they can meet Him when they get here. Amen? And so it's not that our church is a big deal. Our Savior is a big deal. And that is what we have to be focused on. The key to John's peace was simple. His whole life had been about Jesus. He was born to declare the coming of the Lord. His entire ministry was a signpost, a flashing arrow that pointed people to the Messiah. And when He arrived, John rejoiced that Jesus had come on the scene. When our life is hidden with Christ, when we give Jesus first place, even the painful circumstances of life won't be able to shake our peace, but we must place Christ first. Say that with me. Place Christ first. The key to peace is placing Christ first, and secondly, it's proclaiming Christ fully. Proclaiming Christ fully. John declared the whole truth about Jesus. Now, you can get in trouble today for declaring the whole truth about Jesus. Many people want to take part of the story and leave the rest. Many people believe that Christianity ought to be like going to the buffet bar at the Golden Corral. Amen? You can take this and leave that. You can have a lot of this and a little of that. And you can fix your own plate. Amen? Like Burger King met Jesus. You can come and have it your way. But I want to tell you, John didn't preach that kind of message. John was an equal opportunity preacher. He made everybody mad. I mean, read the message. This guy was rough. He hair-lipped everybody. And if you could make it through that and get to the water, he'd baptize you and tell you to repent. Amen? But he was very, very controversial. He pointed at people. Why was he so controversial? He was telling Jewish people they had to get baptized. You say, why is that such a big deal? You don't understand. In New Testament times, the only people who got baptized were pagan, idol-worshipping Gentiles who stopped worshipping idols and wanted to become a Jew and worship the God of Israel. Being baptized was a symbol of them converting, leaving their old life and becoming a Jew who served the one true and living God. So Gentiles who wanted to leave their idols got baptized when they chose to follow the one true and living God of Israel. And John steps on the scene and looks at these good Jewish people and says to them, you think you're okay because Abraham was your great-great-grandpa. I want to tell you, God doesn't have any grandchildren. He certainly doesn't have any great-great-great-great-great-grandchildren. And the fact that you belong to Abraham counts for nothing in the eyes of God. And then he looks at him and says, you're going to go to hell if you don't repent of your sins and trust in God's Messiah. Well, then the church people show up, and there's two groups. There's the liberals and the conservatives. The liberals are called the Sadducees. They didn't believe in the resurrection. That's why they were sad, you see. And they come down to the water, and John points one finger at them and says, you bunch of snakes, you changed the word of God, and you need to repent so that you can be saved and go to heaven. Well, then on the other side of the Jordan River bank come the Pharisees, and they're the ones who walk down to the water like this. And they look down their nose at everyone because they are the conservatives. Bless God, they don't smoke, drink, dip, chew, or go with girls that do. They dot every I and cross every T. They keep to the letter of the law every rule they can find. They add rules to the law to make sure they don't break the real rules in the law. These people are uptight. Amen. Amen. Here they are. And John looks at them and says, in and your heart's not right with God, you bunch of snakes, you're going to hell too. Get in the water with the Sadducees. Wow. What's the deal here? He's preaching the whole counsel of God. And the amazing thing is, instead of running everybody off, everybody's running to him. The Bible says all Jerusalem, all Judea, all this region of the Jordan, they're all running down there to see this wild man. Amen? I believe this guy could have been Randy Williams' pastor. Amen? Amen. John the Baptist, I'm just rough and tough and straight shooting. Here he is. And he preaches this. And he offends everyone right out of the gate. And people begin to realize, you know what? You're right. I don't love God with all my heart. I don't live for God. Jesus said God is at the center of my heart and life. I need to get that straight. And if the Messiah is coming, I've really got to get it right soon. And so John says, come down and repent. He baptizes them in the Jordan just like they're pagans, because really they are. They're just Jewish pagans. And he baptizes them and brings them up and says, now go live a clean life, because the Messiah is on his way. And then one day the Messiah shows up. Jesus steps down to the water and sees his cousin John and says, why are you here? He says, I'm here to get baptized. And John falls on his knees and says, baptize you? I'm not even worthy to hold your shoes. You see, a disciple would tend to his master, but even a disciple wouldn't hold the sandals or wash the feet of his master. That job was reserved for the lowest house slave, the low man on the totem pole. And John says, I'm not even worthy to be your disciple. I'm not even worthy to be your house slave and tote your sandals and wash your feet, much less baptize you. What are you talking about? And Jesus says, let it be done. And when he baptizes him, the Holy Spirit comes on him and the Father speaks from heaven. But when he arrives on the scene, John points that day and tells us the truth about Jesus. He says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I preached about, John said. This is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit and fire. This is the one whose fan is in his hand and will thoroughly purge his floor, gathering the wheat into the garner and burning the chaff with unquenchable fire. What does he proclaim about Jesus? Well, he tells us, number one, Jesus died to save from sin. He says, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. When he sees Jesus, he announces, here's the Savior. You see, the reason a lot of people don't have peace is because they've never dealt with their sin. They don't have peace with other people. They don't have peace in their relationships. They just can't seem to make it work. Every time they get close, it just flies apart. They don't have peace in their own heart. They're not at peace with themselves. They're laid down with guilt. They're embarrassed about their past. They're wearing a lot of shame from the things that they've done, and they've never dealt with their sin. And if you're going to know the peace of God, the first thing you've got to do is deal with your sin. You've got to realize that Christ has got to be first in my life. I've got to humble down and realize life's about Him. It's not about me. I'm just the best man. He is the big deal. He's the group. And then we have to understand that we have to fully proclaim Jesus. We have to receive Christ as John preached it. We have to be saved from our sin. If you want the peace of God, deal with your sin. You can't live in sin and have peace. It always amazes me when people will come and say, Pastor, pray for me. I just don't have any peace in my life. And then I'll ask them some questions about their life, and they'll talk about the sin that they're living in. Well, I'm sorry, I can't pray for you to have peace when you're living in sin. First of all, I'm wasting my breath. God's not going to hear my prayer or yours as long as you're insisting on holding on to your old way. Right? This isn't going to work. There is no peace, says my God, for the wicked. That's the Old Testament. That's the phrase. No peace, says my God, for the wicked. There's no peace for us as long as we choose to live outside of God's commands. But if we'll repent of our sin, we'll find that Jesus is the Lamb of God who stands ready to take away those sins. He'll forgive you of your sin today. He'll wash your heart clean. He will make you new. But until you recognize that you are a rebel, that you are a fugitive, that you are a criminal who's determined to live like your own queen or your own king of your own little kingdom, until you repent of your treason, until you raise the white flag of surrender to Jesus, until you bow your knee to Christ, you'll never know a day of peace. Just here to tell you. Because peace comes when we receive Jesus on His terms. God has come and given us His Son, the Lord Jesus. Jesus came to bring an end to the fighting between man and God. He came to reconcile us to God by the death of His cross. The war between you and God can end this morning, but you've got to run up the white flag and say, I surrender to Jesus. I will go your way, God. I will do it your way. And if you're not willing to do that, then I'm sorry. We really have nothing to offer to you today. Because all we have to offer is Jesus. And Jesus says, if you're going to come to me, you come on my terms. Wow. Pastor, is that the only way? You are. Thank God there is a way. You hear me? We come by way of Jesus, or we don't come to God at all. That's what Jesus said. Straight is the gate, narrow the way, few there be to find it. But if you'll turn from your sins today, if you'll receive Christ as your Savior, then you can be forgiven and you can know the peace of God. Sign the peace treaty that God made at the cross. Sign your name and say, I repent, I turn from my sin, I give my heart to you, Jesus. And the war between you and God will stop. And you'll find out that the war between you and a lot of other people will stop too. You hear me? Get your heart right with God, and all of a sudden it gets real easy to get right with other people. As long as you're fighting God, you'll fight everybody that looks like Him or reminds you of Him. Mm. What's the second thing John preached about Jesus? He preached that Jesus ascended to baptize with the Holy Spirit. I love this. You get to preach Pentecost at Christmas. I love it. John the Baptist said, not only is He the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Why does John focus on this? Because it's wonderful to have my sins forgiven, but that isn't enough. That's not everything Jesus came to do. Jesus didn't come to forgive me of my sin and then leave me to live my own life all over again. Jesus came not only to forgive my sin and set me free from sin, He came to fill me up with His Holy Spirit so that I can live a new kind of life, an overcoming life. Jesus comes to empower me with the Holy Spirit of God so that I can live a life that honors and pleases God. I can walk above the pull of the world and the flesh and the devil. I can walk in victory and experience an overcoming life. Thank God I'm not responsible for facing the battle in my own strength. Thank God I don't have to face the trials of life and the temptations of the devil in my own power. God will fill you with the Holy Spirit, and He will give you the power to stand in the face of trial and temptation. So if you haven't done it today, receive Jesus as Savior. And if you have, receive His promise that He comes to baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire and to give you the power to stand in an evil world for God. Amen? Amen. What else did John preach? He preached He's the coming King. He's the soon coming Judge. He will return to judge the world. He's coming and His fan is in His hand. He will thoroughly purge His floor. He will gather the wheat in the garner and He will burn the chaff with unquenchable fire, Matthew 3:12 says. There's great peace in knowing that Jesus is coming to judge the world. Pastor, that's kind of scary. It is if you hadn't settled out of court. Amen. I settled out of court. Aren't you afraid to stand before the Lord Jesus? No! My heavenly attorney Jesus stood before the judgment bar of God and He gave me a plea bargain. And when I stand and plead the blood of Jesus, my sins are forgiven and I will face the wrath and judgment of a holy God over my sin because Jesus dropped the charges against me at the cross. Amen. I'm not afraid for Jesus to come. I'm excited about Jesus coming. It's a good day for the children of God when Jesus comes again. Amen? It's our blessed hope. So we wait in hope and we can be at peace with His coming. Why? Because it won't always be like it is now. Oh, how glorious that is. It won't always be like it is now. Advent reminds us the darkness has to give way to the light. The dark night of sin was pierced by Jesus, the day spring, the dawn from on high when He came the first time. But He will return one day and it won't be the rays of the dawn breaking over the horizon. No, it will be the inbreaking of the blazing noonday sun. And the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in His wings. And the darkness of night and sin and death and sorrow and disease and injustice will be banished forever. It'll flee before His face. Wow. Aren't you scared of the Antichrist? No. The Lord will destroy him with the brightness of His coming. When Jesus pierces the sky, everything that stands in His way will melt before Him. Not afraid of anything. I'm like the little woman that the Alabama State Trooper pulled over. Pulled her over and she said, sir, I think you ought to know that I have a firearm in the vehicle. He said, okay. And she went and laid it on the dashboard. She said, hold on, I have two more in my purse. And she laid them up on the dashboard. And she said, and I should also let you know, there's one in the glove box and there's two in the trunk. The Alabama State Trooper said, ma'am, what are you afraid of? And she said, not a thing. Not a thing. Amen. Pastor, what are you afraid of in becoming the Lord? Not a thing. Why? We're on the right side of this. It won't always be like it is. We don't have to fear our enemies. We'll be made His footstool one day. Jesus is coming. Meanwhile, what do I do? Well, I can be a peacemaker. Why? Because I know that at the end, peace is going to win. I can work for justice. But Pastor, we often get set back when we work for justice. And we often try to do good things, and those good things get shut down, and they don't get very far. Do them anyway. Why? Because they work. Well, I don't know if they work or not, but I'll tell you what they are. They're a witness to the world. They announce to the world that one day the good guys are going to win. One day the light is going to push out the darkness. One day Jesus' kingdom is going to take over all the other kingdoms. It's going to happen one day. It won't always be like this. The light shined in the darkness. The darkness couldn't understand it, but the darkness can't stop it either. Jesus is Savior, Holy Ghost Baptizer, soon coming King. This is the message we preach. How can you have peace in the world today, Pastor? By placing Christ first, by proclaiming Christ fully, and finally by persevering for Christ faithfully. We close the story with our main character in Matthew 11. He's not preaching on the banks of the Jordan anymore. He's languishing in a prison cell. You see, he preached one too many hot messages. He pointed his finger at King Herod one day and said, "It's not lawful for you to have your sister's wife." And King Herod locked him up and put him in jail because he didn't like the sermon. May come a day when a lot of preachers end up in jail, amen, for preaching such sermons. Y'all come visit me in jail, amen. John, can we live stream from prison? Still want my job if I get locked up. Matthew 11, the Bible says that John sends word to Jesus from the prison cell. He's there. He's disillusioned. He's really wondering. He knows that he's about to face the hour of his own death. He's firmly proclaimed that Jesus is the Messiah. But now, when the rubber meets the road, and his head is on the chopping block, he begins to wonder, am I really, really, really sure about this? And he sends word to Jesus, Matthew 11. Now it came to pass, when Jesus finished commanding his 12 disciples, he departed from there to teach in the cities. And when John heard in prison about the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples and said to Jesus, "Are you the coming one, or do we look for another?" Wow. Why did John ask that? Well, it said when he heard about the works of Jesus. You know, I think John wasn't quite ready for the ministry of Jesus. Now, Pastor, you just preached. He proclaimed it, yes, but he didn't fully understand it. John expected what everybody in his day expected. They expected that the Messiah was going to come in on a white horse. He was going to take over the nation, drive out the Romans, and sit on the throne of David. He was going to judge the bad guys and elevate the good guys, and everything was going to be good. He was going to make Israel great again, right? That's what they're expecting. That's what they're waiting on. And all of a sudden, when he's waiting on somebody who's going to come and rain fire down on the enemies of God, and he hears about the ministry of Jesus, and so far nobody has been burned alive. There are no fireworks. There's no one has fallen dead in his presence. No one has been judged by Jesus. No one has been, you know, sent to their judgment or their untimely death. Instead, he hears very different things about Jesus. He hears that the sinners eat with him and are received by him. He hears that people are being healed and demons are coming out and even the dead are being raised. And he hears these things about Jesus. And he begins to question. Why? Why does this make him question? Well, this isn't what he expected out of the Messiah. And so he gets disillusioned. You know, John is just like us. Sometimes when God doesn't work the way we think he ought to work, we get disillusioned. Sometimes when things don't go the way we had it played out in our mind, the way we thought God was going to pull it off, we get discouraged. And we begin to doubt our faith. And we begin to wonder, is God really God? Is God really good? Is God really for me? Does God really love me? We wrestle with those questions. John the Baptist wrestled with that. He struggles. Jesus, you're not doing the things I thought you were going to be doing. Are you the one that I've really preached about? Are you the one who's coming? Or should we wait for another? Should we look for another? Interesting, isn't it? He misunderstood that the coming of the Messiah was going to be twofold. Jesus was coming in two phases. His first coming as the Son of Mary, the Son of Man, the babe of Mary, was to inaugurate God's kingdom. He came as God's suffering servant. But he was going to come again one day as God's conquering king, to consummate that kingdom and to rule the world. John got upset. He began to question the long-awaited Messiah. When life takes a sour turn, it's hard to remember that through our trials, God is still the same. Our trials change many things about us, they don't change anything about God. But we sometimes struggle to believe that. Painful circumstances can cloud our vision about Christ. It's easy to lose sight of God's promises whenever we're hurting. Corrie ten Boom once said, "Don't doubt in the dark what God showed you in the light." But that's easier said than done, isn't it? When you're in the dark. We struggle. Jesus is so gentle with John. Listen to the answer he sends him. He doesn't scold him. He doesn't fuss at him. He doesn't say, "Why, how dare you doubt me?" Or, "Oh, you little faith, haven't you really fallen from a high place?" No, Jesus doesn't do any of that. Jesus answers him by sending him back a message, and the message is from the Word of God. Jesus basically sends him back and quotes for him the Old Testament. What do you mean? Jesus says, "Go back and tell John this. Remind John the Baptist that the Messiah doesn't just come to bring God's judgment and take the throne of David. The Old Testament says the Messiah will do some other things too." What do you mean? Well, go back and remind John that Isaiah 35, verse 5 and 6 says that when the Messiah comes, the eyes of the blind will be opened and shall see, and the ears of the deaf shall hear, and the lame man will run and leap like a hart. Remind him of that, and tell him what you've seen in my ministry. And then remind them that Isaiah 61 and 1 says, when the Messiah comes, the poor who've been overlooked by everyone else will finally have the gospel preached to them. And you go tell them that the blind see, the deaf hear, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. Wow. What did Jesus do? He said, go remind them of the promises and show them how I'm fulfilling the promises. What is our anchor? How can we have peace when we're hurting? Anchor yourself to the Word of God. Tie yourself to the book. Don't live life based on your circumstances. Live life based on the promises of God. Live your life based on this Word. God's Word will sustain you when everything is shaking and moving around you. Amen. John tells the disciples, go tell him that God's promises are being fulfilled. Verse 6 is the key. Blessed is the one who is not offended on account of me. The word offended means blessed is the one who doesn't stumble. Blessed is the one who doesn't fall away on the account of me. Jesus says, you'll be a blessed man if you don't lose your faith right now, John. You'll be blessed by God if you don't cash in your chips and go home just because things aren't going the way that you want them to. John, this is the greatest test you've ever been through. Can you believe that I am the Messiah? Can you believe that I will fulfill all the promises of God to Israel and to you? Can you believe it? Oh, you can believe it on the Jordan River bank when the heaven opened. You can believe it when the Spirit came down and the voice spoke from heaven. You can believe it when the crowds were running into the Jordan River to be baptized. You can believe it when you were on top of the world. John, now, languishing in a prison cell, hearing the executioner sharpen the axe that will take your head from your shoulders. John, blessed are you if your faith can hold through this last test. Blessed are you if you're not offended on the account of me. Blessed are you if you don't lose your faith because I'm not doing this the way you thought I would do it. Blessed are you if you can trust in me when I'm not going by your playbook. Blessed are you when you can trust me even when life isn't going like you thought it would or hoped it should. Blessed are you when not when everything's going well, but in the middle of life going sour, you can stand and say with the prophet, though the fig tree does not blossom, though there be no fruit on the vine, though the labor of the olive may fail, I will rejoice in God my Savior. John, don't lose your faith now. You're too near the reward for your journey. Amen? Let me ask you today, how do you live in peace? You live in peace there today. You live in God's peace by placing Christ first. You live in God's peace by believing on Jesus fully. Everything that He says He is, you claim Him for that in your life. You live in God's peace today. How? You live in God's peace by persevering faithfully for Christ, no matter what's going on around you. If John's life had been all about himself, he never would have made it. He would have said, if God's good, why is this happening to me? If this is what happens when you serve God, I'm not going to serve Him anymore. But John's life was about the kingdom. It wasn't about himself. It was about Jesus, not him. And so John was able to stand. All he needed to know to be encouraged was that God was still on the throne, Jesus was still who he believed Him to be, and the kingdom of God was still going forward. Even if John didn't live to see it, it was going to happen. And John could die in peace because of that. John could wait in hope, Even though it might take some time for the kingdom to arrive. Even though it might take some time for Jesus to do all that God promised him to do. He could wait in hope. And John could die in peace. Why? He'd already met the one whose death would cover all of his sins. The one who would take the sting out of death for every believer. He had met him already. John here is like Simeon in the book of Luke. Simeon, this old man, is waiting. And when he finally meets Jesus and holds the baby up in his arms, he says, Lord, now your servant can depart in peace. Now I can die in peace. Why? My eyes have seen your salvation. Salvation is a person. His name is Jesus. And when you've met him, you can have peace in any circumstance. If you're wrestling and struggling, check your relationship status. Amen? Are you connected to Jesus? Are you in relationship with him? Stand with me all over the Lord's house. I want to leave you with a question today. Can you say what John says here? Can you say what Simeon said? Can you say, now I can die in peace, my eyes have seen the Lord's salvation? Can you stand here today and say, I'm ready? I know that I'm going to be okay, even if things don't go the way I want them to. I know that Jesus is who he says he is, and that his promises are true. And I know that even if I face the hour of my own death, I'll be okay. Not because I'm a big deal, but because I have surrendered my life to Jesus. He's the big deal. And everyone who anchors in him will make it safely home. Amen. Let me ask you today, are you there? Can you say that? Are you living in peace? Can you endure the current trials of your life in peace? Can you face the hour of your own death in peace? Can you face the death of your loved ones in peace? Can you face the difficulty that seems to be getting worse instead of better this season with the peace of God? John shows us the only way to be at peace and wait in hope is to place Christ first, proclaim and believe in him fully, and then persevere and plow through faithfully until he comes again. We're the people who wait in hope. We're the people who live in peace. Do you have the peace of God? You can. Peace is a person. He is our peace, Paul says, who's broken down the wall between us and him. Do you have the peace of God? If not, you can. How? Come. Find a place to kneel along these steps. Step down from your throne. Run up the white flag of surrender and say, Lord Jesus, I'm not going to live like I'm the center of the universe anymore. I'm going to give my heart and my life to you. I'm going to trust you. I'm going to ask you to forgive my sin. Come into my heart. I'm going to believe you to be God's Lamb who washes away my sin. I'm going to ask you to fill me up with your Spirit so I can live a new life. And I'm going to live my life in confidence that it won't always be like it is now. And I want to know that I'm on the right side of your reign when you show up on the earth again. And I will be able to say, oh yes, not oh no, at the coming of Jesus. Are you ready? Do you have the peace of God? Peace comes through a relationship with Christ. You can know it today. You can have it today. Come trust the Savior. Let's pray. The altar's open. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for your people. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the message and the life of this character, John the Baptist, who challenges us all how to live in peace in the middle of much difficulty. Father, I pray today that you bless us. I pray that you'd open our hearts and minds to you. I pray if there's one in the house today who's not right with God, that as we sing a parting hymn, today be the day they come and kneel and say, Lord Jesus, I surrender my life to you. Lord, come and have your way this morning. Come and move among us in power in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing to the Lord. If you didn't come to pray, the altar's open. If not, we're going to pray for you this morning.